James chapter 2, where we're going to be looking at. Preached a series several years ago, right after I first come here to Eastside on the book of James, and I called it James Must Have Been a Bad Dancer, because he's always getting on your toes. And that's what James is doing. He's going to do this morning. He's going to get on our toes a little bit, and he's going to convict us a little bit through the word here this morning. But before we get into it, we're going to do our spiritual breathing this morning. We're going to take a moment. All that junk, all that stuff, any burdens you brought in here, anything that's bothering you this morning, let's just take a moment as you breathe out to let go of that. I've told this story several times. I'm going to tell it again. The reason I started doing this, the reason that we do this spiritual breathing every morning, years ago, most of y'all know that I was licensed ordained out of Unity. That was my old church, the church we're going to visit tonight. And we had a little old children's altar in one of the Sunday school rooms. We had a little old altar sitting in there with a little cushioned knee pad for the kids to come to. And they would go in there and they'd kneel and they wrote all over it. They wrote their prayers all over it. But every Sunday morning, Sister Carol Martin would take them youngins back here before Sunday school ever started. Them little kids would just line up at that altar. They'd get down at that altar and they'd pray. And they'd praise God. And boy, we seen some things happening with them little kids. And I thought, what if adults did that? What if adults did that? So this is your opportunity this morning. This is your time to get at the altar of God this morning, to ask God just to clear your heart, clear your mind, prepare you for the written word this morning, to prepare you for the Spirit of God this morning, to let Him minister to you. So as you breathe out, let go of all that junk, let go of those burdens, clear your heart, clear your mind, empty yourself of yourself, and as you breathe back in, you ask God to fill you with His perfect Holy Spirit. James chapter 2, verses 1 through 9. He says, "My brethren, do not hold the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, with partiality. For if there should come into your assembly a man with gold rings and fine apparel, and there should also come in a poor man in filthy clothes, and you pay attention to the one wearing the fine clothes and say to him, 'You sit here in a good place,' and say to the poor man, 'You stand there,' or 'Sit here at my footstool,' have you not shown partiality among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my beloved brethren, has God not chosen the poor of this world to be rich in faith and heirs to the kingdom which He promised to those who love Him? But you have dishonored the poor man. Do not the rich oppress you and drag you into the courts? Do they not blaspheme that noble name by which you are called? If you really fulfill the royal law according to the Scripture, 'You shall love your neighbor as yourself,' you do well. But if you show partiality, you commit sin and are convicted by the law of transgressors." Father, I thank You again for another opportunity to preach this morning, Lord. Father, I pray again that I can just decrease, You'll increase, Lord, that You'll hide me behind Your cross. Father, I pray that if this is the last time that I ever have the opportunity to preach, Lord, that I pour out everything that You've poured into me, Lord. And Father, I pray that Your Spirit go before me, preparing the hearts, preparing the minds of each and every person here, Lord. If there's one person under my voice that doesn't know Jesus as their Lord and Savior, I pray this morning that You prepare their hearts to receive the Lord Jesus. And Father, once again, I just pray that You bind Satan, loose Your spirit on this group of people whom You love, in Jesus' name, amen. So there's a story about a preacher in a church that catered only to the rich and the important people. And he's preaching this one Sunday morning. He's preaching to this beautiful and polished congregation he's got. And a bum walks in and he sits down. Now the preacher, he continued preaching, but in the back of his mind, he's wondering, what am I going to do about this? How am I going to deal with this bum that is going and sit down amongst all these polished and pretty people I got here, all these beautiful, rich folks I've got? How am I going to deal with this bum that's coming there? Because the preacher was concerned, that he'd lose some of his congregation. And he knew what that equaled. He knew that if he lost some of his congregation, he would in turn lose a little bit of the benefits to his pocketbook. So after the sermon was over, the preacher, he gives an invitation and he invites people to come forward and all. And this bum comes forward. He comes up there and asks to join the church. So the preacher did the only thing he knew to do to put the situation off. He says, why don't you just go home and pray about it and see what God has to say about it? Tells the bum to go home, pray about it, see what God has to say about it. Bum says, fair enough, I'll do that. And to the preacher's relief, the next Sunday the bum was not there. And for 6 months following that, he never seen the bum, never heard nothing out of the bum, anything like that. And then one day, the preacher is walking down the street, and he sees the bum. He runs into him on the street. And out of nothing more than curiosity, the preacher asked him, what had happened? What had happened with his prayer? Did you go and did you pray like I told you to? The bum says, yeah, I did. Matter of fact, I did. The bum told him, he said, I prayed 3 different times and got the same answer each time. So I did what God said to do. The preacher, he just had to know. He had to know what God had told the bum. So he asked him, he said, what did God tell you? The bum replied, well, God told me not to worry about joining your church. He said he's been trying to get in it for 20 years and he hasn't made it in yet either. How many times you been in a church where someone's put on a pedestal because of their status quo? We've seen it happen in churches. People put on a pedestal just because of who they are or what they represent or something. Maybe it's someone wealthy that gives a lot to the church. You know, you can't lose in big tithers because, you know, we depend on them. We don't depend on God. We got to have these big tithers. Can't lose them, folks. We've seen them in our churches before. Maybe it's somebody, a local businessman with a lot of political pull. I served in a church a long time ago, had a man like this. Now, this man, he was a very humble man, but people actually visited the church because they would try to get this man's endorsement. They knew he had some political connections, knew he was in the right clique in town. And they would actually, we had folks visit the church for that very reason. We've all probably seen somebody make a fuss over someone just because of who they are at some point or another, just because of who they might be. On the flip side, let's talk about this for a minute. How many times have we seen someone put a bum on a pedestal? You don't see that, do you? You don't see them put the bum on the pedestal. Or how about a single mother with a dozen kids running around? We don't put them on a pedestal, do we? What we generally do is we get off by ourselves and we talk a little junk about these folks, don't we? We've all been guilty of that at one point or another. We've all probably did that. And truth be known, what we're doing, we're holding them in lower esteem than the average person. We tend to categorize folks socially, you know? We tend to categorize folks socially. And we don't seem, in the church, we don't seem to care as much when one of these lower class lead as we do when one of these higher class do with them. So you take somebody that might not fit the mold, that somebody might be a little different, somebody that might be, you know, outside your little box that you've built for yourself. And we don't tend to be as upset when somebody like that leaves the church as somebody that just fits in. And I'm not just talking about this church. I'm talking about churches all across the nation. We've all been guilty of it at one point or another. And James is about to get on our toes about that very thing. He's got a lot to say about that. And he's fencing to get on our toes about it. Now, understand, James is not introducing something new here. This is from way back, way back. We can go way back to Deuteronomy, the 5th book in the Bible, and find this concept that James is drawing from. Deuteronomy 1:17 says, you shall not show partiality in judgment. You shall hear the small as well as the great. You shall not be afraid in any man's presence, for the judgment is God's. The case that is too hard for me, for you, bring to me, and I will hear it. The 5th book of the Bible, God warns us about partiality. God warns us right there in the 5th book of the Bible, right back. James, though, he's about to take this and he's going to expound on it. We're going to look at that this morning. We're going to break it down a little bit this morning. We're going to start verses 2 through 4. Verses 2 through 4, he says, for if there should come into your assembly a man with gold rings and fine apparel, and there should also come in a poor man in filthy clothes, and you pay attention to the one wearing the fine clothes and say to him, you sit here in the good place, and say to the poor man, you stand there and sit here at my footstool, have you not shown partiality among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Instead of honoring Jesus Christ, James' readers were revering the rich and despising the poor. And James gets on them about it. They showed favoritism to the man that had an outward appearance of wealth, and they disregarded the man of poor status. I read a book I got in my office. Anybody wants to read it one day? I got a copy of it back here. It's called America's Churches Through the Eyes of the Bible. Several of y'all have read it as well. This book was written by a man. I know the man personally. His name is Richard Hedricks. He's the founder of the Hellfighters Motorcycle Ministry. Lives in, that place. I can't think of the name of it right now. Mississippi, anyway. Very successful businessman, Laurel, Mississippi. Very successful businessman that has done well for himself. But him and his wife, they used to go around, and he writes this book about their experiences. They went around to different churches posing as bums. And they'd generally be camped outside in an area that people had to... People couldn't intentionally avoid it. People would have to come by them. People would have to pay them attention. If you ignored them, you were doing it intentionally. They would get in an area that people had to notice them. And people would walk right by them, and he tells these stories in the book. They would get so many different reactions. They've been asked to leave. They've had folks ask them to leave. Just get off the campus or get off the church ground. They were invited in a lot of times. In all fairness, they were invited in a lot of times, but a lot of times they were asked to sit in the back so that they wouldn't offend any of the parishioners. They've been offered food. Churches offered them food. They've also had the cops call on them. They tell these stories throughout the book. Most of the time, however, they were just ignored. And the whole time when they come visit these churches, the pastor of the congregation would be in on it. In fact, the bum would eventually reveal himself as the guest speaker for the day. Imagine what folks thought after they had ignored this guy, said ugly things to him, whatever they might have done, and he steps up and takes the pulpit as their guest speaker for the day. And he would almost always start his sermons off with Matthew 25:35-36 says, "For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you took me in. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came to me." Remember the Lord's story about the sheep and the goats that you find in Matthew 25? The people asked the Lord, "When did we do these things? When did we do these things you're talking about?" And the Lord replies to them, he says, "If you did these things to the least of my brethren, you did them to me. To the least of my brethren, you did them to me." And that's when they would find out that this bum they'd been so indifferent to was in fact a very successful businessman. Now let's think about that scenario and be honest with ourselves this morning. What if that bum would have been a well-dressed man wearing a Rolex, you know, three-piece suit and tie, you know, somebody that obviously had money? How would we have treated him? Would we have seated him on the back row so as not to offend people? We'd probably show him off, wouldn't we? Got him up here and danced him around if we got a chance. Never would have called the cops on somebody like that, would we? And we make excuses and we tell ourselves, say, "Well, you know, we got to protect our children. That bum might have been a pedophile or something." Here's a news flash for you. There are wealthy pedophiles as well. Amen?
That's right.
Without even realizing it, we have done exactly what James is warning us about if we're not careful here. We have shown partiality. And what James is really trying to do is get us to look at people through the eyes of Jesus. That's what James is really trying to do here. To look past the outward appearance and to look at the inward man. To put off our evil thoughts and show agape love regardless. Y'all remember the story of Jesse and his sons? Remember, Samuel goes to Jesse. God had told Samuel to go to Jesse and one of his sons would be the next king. And Samuel goes and he says, look at this. This is a good looking man. This boy here, that's got to be him. God says, nope, that ain't him. He goes this next thing and he says, well, this is here. He's big and he's strong and he's all that. God says, no, that ain't him. He goes through all Jesse's sons. And then there's this ruddy little scrawny boy at the end, the youngest of the boys. He said, well, this is the only son left. This can't be it. God says, that's the one. And God tells him, he said, I don't look at the outward appearance. I look at the heart of the man. Amen. Verse 5, he said, listen, my beloved brethren. Has God not chosen the poor of this world to be rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom which he promised to those who love him? Most people, now there's exceptions. What I'm about to say, but most people the Lord chooses are not powerful or affluent. They're not powerful or affluent. There are definitely some out here, but statistically they make up a very small percentage of Christianity. As a matter of fact, compared to a large portion of the world's population, we are the wealthy ones. You understand that, don't you? We in America are the wealthy ones compared to a large portion of the world's population. Everybody here, as far as I know, has a solid roof over your head. Everybody here has a means to get food for your family. This ain't like it in every place. We're kind of sheltered people. Y'all understand? We are kind of sheltered. Some of y'all have been with me to the Dominican, and we've probably seen some of the better parts of the Dominican. I hear Haiti's a lot worse than the Dominican, and they're on the same island. And we've seen folks there that lived in stuff we wouldn't want to use as storage sheds and proud of them. We've seen folks there where their chicken and their chickens roam through the house, their cows just walking around the yard, and the goats come walking through the house. And, you know, this is the way they live. But we think, man, that's nasty, that's filthy. You know what we've seen? I've told y'all, my biggest takeaway first time I went there was how content them people are with what we consider nothing. Because they had a roof over their head. They didn't always know where their next meal was coming from. The roof over their head weren't, you know, nothing like we would be excited about as spoiled Americans like we are. They didn't always know where their next meal was coming from. They didn't always know. A lot of them worked from day to day. They didn't know if they'd have a job the next day. You know, most of us have steady employment. These people didn't know. They worked the fields, and they might have employment for them one day. They might not the next. Very few of them had steady employment. They did what they had to do to provide. As far as I know, everybody here has a solid roof over your head. Everybody here has a means to feed your family. Everybody here is clothed today, praise the Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord. Everybody here has clothes. Look at what the ladies are doing. Yeah, yep. Look at what the ladies are doing with the sewing ministry. They talked about it. They were talking about it in Sunday school this morning. Talking about it tonight. They're making simple little dresses. If you've never checked out the sewing ministry, I strongly encourage you to check out the sewing ministry. There's pictures online. Ask some of these ladies about it. Get them to show you some things. But they make these simple little dresses that they know are going to bring a lot of joy to little girls that they will never meet. It blows my mind at the way the little dresses have been used. This little church has reached so many people with these little dresses. And then they make these pot holders too. And these pot holders, that really got to me. They're making pot holders for these foreign families. The reason that got to me, this is something I'd have never thought of. Pot holders? I mean, what's the big deal? You're sending pot holders over there. Well, that's just something we take for granted. You know, we ain't got a pot holder. We run to Walmart and get another. We don't think about it. And then you talk to these missionaries, and they're talking about how grateful for these ladies are to have pot holders, because now they don't have to use the hem of their dress to wrap around this hot handle and set it. They can't just run to Walmart or to the dollar store. The dollar store might have them on every corner here, but they haven't made it quite there yet. They're not quite there over there. I'm looking for it any time. But they haven't quite made it there yet. These things are blessings to them. Potholders. I mean, potholders. Who would have thunk it? I mean, these are things we take for granted. And you know what we say? We say, I sure am the Lord. I sure am glad the Lord blessed me like he did. I'm just so blessed. I'm just so blessed. Let me ask you, do you really? Do we really know what it's like to truly depend on God? To wonder where your next meal's coming from? You ever thought that maybe it was the impoverished Christians that were really blessed? That's a hard pill to swallow right there, ain't it? Maybe it's them that are really blessed. Blessed with a measure of faith I don't know that I could have. They are blessed with a measure of faith that I'm not sure that I could have. I know I'm going to have a meal when I get home today. I know I got a roof over my head. I know there's clothes in my closet. I know I've got a job tomorrow when I get there. Are we really the blessed ones? Remember, biblical prosperity is not riches and stuff like that. It's walking hand in hand with God. These people are prosperous when it comes to that. Look at verses 6 and 7. He says, but you have dishonored the poor man. Do not the rich oppress you and drag you into the courts? Do they not blaspheme that noble name by which you are called? James describes the faulty thinking of his readers. He said, here are the poor God wants to bless, yet James' readers ignore them. Here are the rich who are cheating them, yet James' readers give them honor. There really hasn't been a whole lot changed today. A celebrity dies, and what? It's all over the news, ain't it? It is all over the news. Dignitaries, they'll go to the funerals and they'll make statements. They'll show up there and they'll make just this big old production out of things. It captures the attention of the world. It'll capture the attention of the world. And the media makes a huge deal out of it. You let a celebrity die and people start showing up, and the media makes all this fuss about it. Meanwhile, a soldier dies defending freedom, and no one seems to notice. Maybe that celebrity dies of a drug overdose, and all of a sudden we need more drug awareness. Meanwhile, the addict who's cried out for help time and time again goes unnoticed. James says, quit doing that. Our society gives honor based on the status quo. Our churches cannot do that. Amen? That ought to be something we get passionate about. That ought to be something we are adamant about, that we pursue. Verses 8 and 9, before I really get on a high horse, we better move on. If you really fulfill the royal law according to the scripture, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. You do well. But if you show partiality, you commit sin or are convicted by the law as transgressors. Who is your neighbor? Who is your neighbor? It's not just the people on each side of you. It's not the people who live next door to you. It's anybody you come in contact with. Rich, poor, old, young, black, white, popular, despised by many, they're all your neighbor. And the Bible says we're to love them. And James says, if you love them, you do well. You do well if you love them. But if you show partiality, you commit sin. And the law points that sin out to you. And once you're aware of that sin, you've got a choice to make. Once you've become made aware of that sin, you have a choice to make. You can harbor it. You can harbor it, and you can hold on to it, and you can even enjoy it if you want to. You can enjoy that sin if you want to, and you'll find yourself moving away from God. Remember last week I preached on that a little bit? Talking about it's never God that moves, it's us that moves. What God says, I'll never leave you or forsake you. So if you feel distance from God, it's not God that's moving. God is true. God keeps his promises. It's us that's moved away from him. And that's what happens when we start harboring this sin, when we start enjoying our sin. But if you repent of it, you can enjoy the blessings that God has for you through it. There's no... James' whole point here. Doesn't matter who you are, you're welcome. They should be welcome into the body of Christ. They should be welcome into our churches. They should be welcome into our fellowships. I'm not talking about welcoming in their sin. I'm talking about it doesn't matter what they've been through, where they are, what their status quo is. We welcome them in. James is doing away with cliques is what he's doing. I don't like church cliques. I try. I don't think we have too many out here. If we do, we need to nip them in the bud. If somebody sees we got a clique, let me know. We'll try to nip it in the bud. We want everybody to come into fellowship. We want everybody. You know, we have worked. This is kind of a rehash, a remix of a message I preached several years ago. We have tried to cultivate a culture of acceptance here at Eastside. I want the ones that the other churches don't want to accept. I want them here. I want them hearing the gospel. I want to see a church full of misfits. You know why I want to see a church full of misfits? Because I'm a misfit in the eyes of God. And I have fallen short of the glory of God. And I know I'm not perfect. I know that if I had to stand before a holy God on my own, I'd be doomed to hell. But I don't. Thank God for Jesus. Thank God for Jesus. If we're going to minister, we have to get our hands dirty. You understand that? If we're really going to get into ministry, we have to get our hands dirty. And you're going to be called upon to minister to some of the less desirables. Bottom line is God is not a respecter of man, and your heart is just as stained by sin as the next guy. And for that reason, we all need a Savior. Romans 3:10 says, none are righteous, no, not one. Not the bum, not the rich man. Not the preacher, not the pope. None are righteous, no, not one. And he goes on to say, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. You know who all is? You know who all is? All is everybody. It's all. It's all of us. Every one of us has sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Rich, poor, black, white, yellow, brown. It doesn't matter who you are or what you are. You have fallen. You have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And the Bible tells us the wages of sin is death. So because you've sinned, you deserve death. You're going to get death. But he puts a clause in there. He puts a but in there. He inserts a but. He says, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus, our Lord. And the Bible says that God demonstrates his own love toward us. And then while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. I'm so glad God didn't say, well, you got to get right and then you come to it. That's what a lot of churches say, don't they? Well, y'all get right. You get dressed right. You get to talking right. You get to acting right and then you come on. God didn't say that. He said, and while you were yet sinners, while you were yet wallowing in your sin, in your filth, and all the things that God abhors, he still loves you and he still wants you to come to repentance in Christ Jesus. God demonstrates his own love toward us. And then while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. He didn't wait for us to get it right. He made it right for us. And Romans 10:9 says, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. I remember seeing a church sign one time that had this verse up there. And it said, you may be saved. You can't twist the scriptures like that. That's not what God said. He said, you believe on the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. You shall be saved. You confess the Lord Jesus. Believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead. You shall be saved. Welcome one, welcome all. I want to see them all come in. Don't you, Brother Mark? Me and Brother Mark was talking about that. I want to see the young, the old. I want to see the less fortunate. I want to see the wealthy. I want to see them all. I love the diversity. I love that we look around this room now and we got diversity. We got diversity in skin tone. We got diversity in social status or whatever you want to call it. We've got diversity in career fields and such as that. I love looking around this room and seeing that because I believe heaven's going to be a lot like that. And Jesus wants you just as you are. Tanil, if you would come up and pray, brother. If you've never cried out to Jesus, if you've never confessed with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and believed in your heart, this is more than just making a statement. This is believing in your heart. This is your heart crying out to Jesus. Believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead. Be safe. I invite you to come forward this morning if you never did that. Come up here and confess. Confess to this whole congregation. Confess to Jesus that he's the Lord. I invite you to come forward this morning. If you never did that, come forward.